Amen. Thank you, Josh. Thank you, guys. Singing along. It's so great to worship with our church family. I do want to encourage you that that's not something you have to wait to do till Sunday. You can actually do that at any time in your life, that God is glorified by that. Just like reading your Bible, hopefully you're not just waiting to hear me read from the scripture today. That's something you could do every day. In fact, man, I don't even know why I say these things when I'm up here. But back when I was like 17 years old, I was delivering pizza in like this backcountry town, right? And I didn't have Christian music, so I would just be like short on CDs or there'd be no stations that I could get. And so when I would drive around, I would only know like three parts of songs from Sundays, and I would just drive around delivering pizza and just like praising God at the top of my lungs, singing like the three parts that I knew. And that's what I would do, but God would be glorified in that, and I just want to encourage you, you can do that too, all right? You don't have to wait until Sunday to participate in worship with all of heaven, because all of heaven is rejoicing. So we've been talking about the idea that that we need to be equipped for the plan that God has for our lives, and that God sets us up for success, that he has a variety of things through which he equips us for every good work. And this isn't just like a general plan, but it's a specific plan for your life. That in Ephesians chapter 2, it says that we are created in Christ Jesus to do the good works that he has foreordained for us to do. That he wants us to succeed at the things that he's called us to do. And so in terms of these good works, all right, I know we might have different ideas of what that would mean. He sets us up for success. We're going to get an idea of what some of those things might look like today. They're not just like, you know, God calling you to go raise the dead. Things that are also very practical and less supernatural than that are good works that God has called you to do. Last week we talked about the things that you shouldn't bring on the journey of life, things that will hold you back, things that will keep you down and result in us being unsuccessful. And today we're going to talk about whether we're fit for the good works that God has called us to do. So we're talking about unfitness and fitness, and I'm excited we get to actually examine. Really, I'm going to read through most of the book of Titus. It's a short letter written to a young pastor by the Apostle Paul. I've got some Bibles along some of the chairs there so you can find it. I didn't look it up. Robin's going to tell you the page number right now. I put her on the spot. Oh, no, I'm just kidding. But yeah, you'll find it. It's towards the back. There's also a table of contents. And you can also have a cell phone, tablet, whatever you got. And page 724. Thank you, Robin. She's bluffing, I think. You guys are all going to let her get away with it, too. She's just making that up. So today we're going to talk about this idea of unfitness, and the Bible is going to be somewhat brutally honest about our state of life pre-Jesus, okay? And so all of us have been at that state, some of us perhaps still are, and I don't want you to unnecessarily be offended by the Bible's clear description, kind of concise, kind of just, you know, very poor bed manner, even in describing how brutally terrible we can be as humanity. So don't be offended at that. That's not something that I want to kind of set you off with, because this is something that every person is kind of born into, this idea that we are opposed to God. We choose to do things our own way. And the Bible doesn't shy away from telling us the bad news, because then that allows us to better understand the goodness of the good news, okay? The idea that God became a man, he lived a perfect life, he lived and dwelt among us, and that he was willing to die in our place for our sins, right? That we could be forgiven, that we could be saved. So that good news really only makes sense if we understand the bad news. So don't be offended if you see some of this strong language, descriptive language when it talks about the pre-Jesus state. Okay, and also I want to point out that Christians don't need to somehow like imagine non-Christians as being bad people to help us feel better about ourselves. That's not the goal at all, because in reality, none of us have earned salvation in our own goodness or our own good works. It's not something that we can do. It's just that I would rather recognize that what God says is true about us than lean towards even what my own heart would wish to describe the world that I live in. Okay, that I trust Jesus because he's the one that died and was raised from the dead, and he's the engineer of humanity, and that God describes the human heart as being utterly deceitful. Okay, so even though I would want to describe the situation differently, even in my own right heart and desires, I recognize that let every man be a liar, that God would be true, is what the Bible says. So he has kind of this clear description of it. And so what I do is I admit that Jesus is right about my heart. All right, I admit that he is right about my need for a savior. And there's no such way through which my own good works could save me. It says this in Galatians 2:21. I don't have it on the screen. It says, "For if keeping the law could make me right with God, then there was no need for Christ to die." And Jesus was willing to die so that we could be saved. And the night before he died, he even prayed to the Father, saying, "If there's any other way, let this cup pass from me." And God's answer to that prayer was that there was essentially no other way, because the next day Jesus had gone and experienced the full kind of suffering that he faced, that he endured through that so that we could be saved. So we believe God in this state, and don't, like I said, be unnecessarily offended. The law of God, the Bible, is a diagnostic test that points out to our need for a Savior. All right, the law of God is not given so that I'm like, okay, if I do enough of these good things, then I'm saved. That's not what it's meant for. And so just like a doctor that would tell you the bad news that you have cancer, which I imagine is a very difficult thing to hear, that doctor is not against you when they say that. That doctor is for you. They're exposing the problem so that a solution can be found and talked about, and right, a remedy can be obtained. And so the Bible is the same way. It is the life-giving word of God intending on bringing salvation and sanctification to you and I. So here we go. So we're going to jump into this letter of Titus in Titus chapter 1, verse 15. It's only 3 chapters long. Typically, a chapter in the Bible is like a page. So don't be scared. We're going to be good. I got my countdown timer here. We're going to be great. Here we go. I'm excited about this. Imagine that we as Valley Town Church just got this letter written to us from the Holy Spirit, right, inspired word of God. What if this was the letter we just got written to us? So here it goes. Titus 1:15, "To the pure, all things are pure, but to the defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure. But both their minds and their consciences are defiled. They profess to know God, but they deny him by their works. They are detestable, disobedient, unfit for any good work." So there's that word kind of unfit where I'm getting the sermon idea. So in terms of pure and undefiled, it's not necessarily talking about sin. Paul is actually addressing a group of people who were Jewish believers at the time. Here, I'll explain it, and we'll see if you have questions at the end. And so he's actually addressing people who believe, they believe in God, who think that they're following God, but yet they're kind of held to all of these religious traditions, and they think that their adherence to, you know, not eating certain foods or practicing certain religious traditions are going to keep them closer to God. All right, and Paul's saying, listen, that's not the case. That even these pure and good things are actually defiled when they pass through our hearts or through our conscience. And Jesus actually addressed this in Matthew 15. He says, "It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but what comes out of the mouth, this defiles a person." He said that, "For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, and slander." So the issue as far as like what defiles a person is their heart. It's not like the environment that they're in. Okay, that humanity taking God's good creation, our response to that was to kind of distort it and destroy it as a result of our seeking our own will, and right, Adam and Eve sort of rebelling against God, and as a result, we are where we are today. So what Paul is saying here is that to the pure person, they can enjoy the good gifts that God's given us. Right? 1 Timothy 6 says that God has given us everything to enjoy on this earth, that there's good things that God's given, but to the person whose heart has not yet been regenerated by God, even the good things God gives can be distorted and twisted into defiling things, right? So it's kind of like a crazy, crazy thing, right? So it says they profess to know God, all right? And in Paul's day, he was talking about in this specific passage, he's talking about Jewish believers who have rejected Jesus as Messiah and who are adhering to the traditions of men and have set aside even the Old Testament word of God. They've exchanged those two things. But also in Paul's day, there were idol worshipers. They were the pagans, right? There were the Romans and all of these different people, and that they kind of would practice idol worship. But he's actually talking about people who claim to know God. And his point is that professing to know God is actually not an indicator of whether or not someone actually does. All right, so like I said, this is going to be an interesting conversation today. All right, but there's a lot of hope here. Okay, so today we even have obviously people who are agnostic who say, well, I don't know if we can know whether or not God exists, or we can know whether or not something is true. And then there's even just like hardcore atheists who are typically materialists who are like, no, there's no evidence of God. The only thing that exists is this world, this physical thing that we can observe, and all that can be known is that which is revealed through science. But regardless of the stance, Paul is making this claim that professing to know God or denying that he exists, right, that we can actually deny God exists not just with our mouths, but by our very actions. That our works are a means through which we can deny God's existence, that we can claim that we are following Jesus, but by our lifestyle, right, the macro trends of our lifestyle, I might say, we could actually deny that he's existing. We're living as though he's not actually there. And this is something that Jesus talked about as well in Matthew 7. He says, on that day, the day of judgment, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And he says, and then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. Right? So just like that's such a heartbreaking passage, right? A heartbreaking idea that there's people that are persuaded in their following Jesus, but Jesus is like, I don't even know you. I don't even know you. And Jesus makes this point. He says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do the things I tell you to do? And so there should be some amount of evidence in our lives that outwardly reveals the change that's taken place on the inside of us. And that's by no means suggesting that Christians should be perfect, because we are not. Okay, Christians who have been changed, who are dead to sin, sometimes that dead body still just kind of like acts up for some reason. You're just going to like get back down, like, right? Just kind of like hide it, get it out of here. Like, this is not the way I'm supposed to be acting, okay? But the point is that it's possible to live a life that is unfruitful. Okay, so the difference between a Christian and a non-Christian isn't whether or not they're sinning, because Christians do sin, but it's whether or not they want to please Jesus. Right, or whether I enjoy and I'm pursuing the sin that I am going after, that I'm experiencing, okay? So that's kind of the difference here. And what's crazy about this verse is that it suggests the idea that I could live a life that's unfruitful, that I could live a life that's of no effect, that I could spend my entire lifetime, and even though time is passing by, I'm not accomplishing the very good that God's called me to do, that I'm missing out on the good works that he's intended for me. That it's possible to be unfit for any good work. All right, and like notice how like I'm wrestling with this myself, right? Just the idea that wait, they're unfit for any good work? Like Paul's suggesting that someone who doesn't trust Jesus can't do anything good? Is that what he's saying? Because like I would even argue, like through experience, like I know people who aren't followers of Jesus who do right good things. But according to God's standard, Jesus said this. He says, there is no one good but God. That according to his standard, or in the book of Isaiah, Isaiah says, my works of righteousness, my good deeds are but filthy rags when I look at the presence of God. Right? So in terms of like our metric for goodness, oh yeah, like, yeah, you know, there are people out there that do good better than we do, right? According to like our human measure of goodness. But what's interesting about this, thinking back to the defiled, right, even the pure things become defiled, that even though someone might do a good thing, that sometimes our hearts and our motives can just be completely offset from where it should be. Like I could just be doing good things for the sake of the public praise that I get, which is what Jesus encountered in his day with the Pharisees, right? They were doing all of these tremendous things. They were giving to the poor. They were, you know, praying in the street. They were doing all these good acts, but they were looking for the public praise, and it was just an act of self-righteousness. right? That even good things can be done for the wrong reason. And that's what Paul is suggesting here, that if I'm doing good, even to try to say, like, you know, I'm going to save myself, that God is going to be pleased by my doing good and I don't need a savior, that's actually something that would be offensive to God, not pleasing to him. Okay, so Titus chapter 2, next verse, verse 1, it says, but as for you, right? So here's going to be some contrast here, and he's actually, this you, I believe he's speaking specifically to Titus, okay? He'll hit different demographics in the church in a moment. But he says, but as for you, so here we should be ready for a contrast, all right? That here's how those who have not yet experienced Jesus act and how those who have experienced Jesus should be acting. Not that they always do it perfectly. So, but as for you, now he's speaking to Titus, he says, teach what accords with sound doctrine. All right, so as a pastor, I don't just get to come here and like just kind of share my opinion or just like kind of whatever is like popular or whatever is like the pop psychology thing of the day. That's not for me to do. Like, that's not what I should be doing. That is that the Bible actually has a standard for those who teach. That what I should be teaching is what's true and reliable. That is the words of truth and life. That I should be, right, teaching and sharing with you the word of God, not just, well, this is kind of cool. Like, let me tell you about this. No. I want to give you something that has been consistent, right, for millennia. That is the word of God, the foundation upon which you can build your life as you hear it and obey. Right, that's what a pastor should be doing. So it's not for a pastor to, you know, just kind of be teaching what's, you know, their opinion is or what is popular. And now he's going to hit different demographics, and if you identify as one of these, so for instance, verse 2, it says older men, so we're not going to put you into categories. You can identify that yourself. Older men, and now he says this, here's an encouragement, are to be sober-minded, dignified, self-controlled, sound in faith, in love, and in steadfastness. Okay, so he's speaking specifically to the older men of the church. And so imagine we just got this letter, and this is what God is speaking to our church today. Right? Imagine if this is what, you know, God is telling the pastor to teach, and this is what we're hearing. These are the things that he is saying in general. If you're an older man who's a follower of Jesus, these are the things that you should focus on. These are kind of the common areas that you should invest in, that you should be growing in. And I find it interesting that it's not like there's ever just a stage of life where we graduate, like I went to Sunday school, I heard about Moses and Noah, I'm good, right? Like, I'm just good. Like, I can just kind of like sit back and just be respected. That's what I need to do. No. Like, there's still work to be done at whatever stage of life you find yourself in. That if you're still on this earth, God is doing the work of sanctification in you. All right, 1 John 3 says that those who have the hope of seeing Jesus return, that they purify themselves just as he is pure. All right, so there's still a work to be done, even if you are, you know, placing yourself in the category of older. Then he says this, older women, likewise, are to be reverent in behavior, not slanderers or slaves to much wine. They are to teach what is good. And so once again, here's some general wisdom shared with us, general areas of growth and concern, saying like, right, don't spend your life just, you know, running around gossiping about people and just slandering people's reputation. Don't be a slave to much wine. Don't just kind of enjoy, you know, retirement and just kind of drinking all day. You can drink some. That's okay. The Bible says that you can. Well, unless like your conscience tells you not to. All right, so I'm not going to like, everybody go drinking today. No. There might be some of us where it's wisdom not to drink at all, so I'll make that point, right? And that they are to teach what is good. This is so cool. This is just the family of God, the way that God set it up, that those who are older women in the church are to be discipling others, that they are to be investing in the next generation, that it's not something for you to just be like, well, I'm all set. You know, I've heard the sermons, I've read the Bible, I've sung the songs, I'm just good. I'm just going to kind of like, you know, do my own thing. But no, that God wants you to be investing in the next generation. And that's where verse 4 comes in. So the older women are to teach what is good, and so train the young women. So that's verse 4, right? To love their husbands and children, and to be self-controlled, pure, working at home, kind, and submissive to their own husbands, right? So the idea is that the older women should be discipling and training the younger women. All right, that this is something that even Paul writing to a pastor, he's saying, listen, pastor, you are not equipped to do this. Right? That there are people in the church that are equipped to disciple one another. That this is not the pastor's job. Right? That older women in the church should be focused on investing in, discipling, raising up, helping to mature the younger women. And don't just like train them in whatever you think is cool, like train them in godliness, train them in what God would have them be doing. Right? And the key emphasis here is to invest in their own families, right? That the younger women should be discipling their families, that they should be investing in their children. Okay, so now it does say the phrase working at home in the ESV version. I don't want us to assume that means women should not work out of the household, because that's not what it means. Okay, all right, so that's why it's important. Like, we think this stuff through, okay? Other translations say that women should be busy at home or keepers at home or managing their own households. Okay, contrasting this, I think it's in 1 Timothy 5. It talks about that there were young widows, and Paul encourages them to be married and to invest in family because he didn't want them to be busy bodies going from house to house gossiping. Okay, so when it says busy at home, it's not meaning like simply just, you know, only work at home. It's meaning don't be one of those busy bodies that was going from house to house and just kind of slandering one another. There's even symmetry in the concepts here where he said not to slander. All right, but what he's emphasizing is that there's an importance, there's a value in raising up a family, and that some of that responsibility, a good share of it, lands on these young women. All right, so he's encouraging them, saying, don't disregard this important calling that God's given you. Right, that you should invest in this area. Also, I'll just mention the submissive piece because, hey, I'll just stick my foot in my mouth here. Here we go. We're hitting all of it today. I'm reading this whole book practically, so here we go. Submissive does not mean less than. It doesn't say that all women should be submissive to all men. It calls for wives to submit to your husbands. You can read that in Ephesians 5 and I think Colossians 3 and 4. And submissive does not suggest that there's inequality at play. Elsewhere in the Bible, it says that Jesus is equal with God, but that Jesus chose to submit to God the Father, that he is God the Son, he submits to God the Father, yet those two are equal. So this is not some disparity between equality, but it is that God calls us to different responsibilities here clearly on this earth. So you can still squirm at that, that's fine, all right? But I'm not even supposed to be teaching that to you. It's the older women that are supposed to teach you that. So I don't even know why I'm having to say anything here. Well, here we go. Let's keep going. Oh man. Let's finish up verse 5. I think I've got the rest of verse 5 on the next slide. It says, that the word of God may not be reviled. So all of these things, the way that a Christian should be living their lives, is done not just for the sake of their own benefit or for the sake of their own obedience to Jesus, but that there's this outward showing, this light that is shown to the community, that if we do this poorly, it results in people reviling the word of God. That it paints Jesus as unattractive when I tell people, hey, I'm a follower of Jesus, and then I live my life in complete contradiction to his word. That it actually makes other people just be like, that does not look appealing to me at all. All right, like I do not want to be a follower of Jesus because of, and then they maybe list a series of examples. Okay, so that it's significant, it's important that the way we live our lives, and notice this was even like our personal lives, our family lives, the way that we live and invest in our own communities and our families, the way that we fight sin in our own hearts, that all of this is important because otherwise the word of God might be reviled. That it's making Jesus look unattractive to our community, right? So that's why these are significant matters. This isn't just something to like brush off. And I do want to point out that it doesn't somehow give those people who would reject Jesus a legitimate excuse. Like if they go up to Jesus on Judgment Day and be like, hey, Jesus, I would have followed you, except let me list off some Christians of yours that I didn't think were behaving quite right. Like that's not going to be a legitimate excuse on that day, okay? But we as Christians should still admit and acknowledge, like, I want to make Jesus look attractive to this community, And there will be things that are offensive regardless, okay, that the truth will offend some, but I want to make sure that I'm not adding additional unnecessary offense or making God look worse because of the way that I live my life. Okay, so that's the idea there. Jesus, by the way, I've got some verses on the bonus content. He talked about the idea of being a light to the world, letting them see your good works, that they would glorify your Father in heaven. So that would be the hope. That would be the contrast to that, that instead of them reviling God's word, hopefully they see glory in God's word, right, and experience his love and his truth as a result of being around us as believers. And now here, this is my favorite verse for this whole book today. Verse 6, now he hits talking about younger men. He says, likewise, urge the younger men to be self-controlled. Like, that is it. Like, that's it. Like, that's all you young guys have to worry about. It's almost as if the Holy Spirit is just like, guys, don't worry about figuring out all of these other things you should be doing. No, no, no. Just, like, focus on not doing the things that you're a slave to. Like, you got to get over this sin issue. Just stop doing that, right? Like that's, like, they didn't give a long list to young guys. I don't know which category I'm in yet either, by the way. But nonetheless, if you are a young man, all right? The Bible urges me to urge you, just focus on self-control. Okay? Amen. Like, that might be all you need to do. Just, there we go. Just be at work fighting the sin in your life. That's it. Okay. And now, verse 7, Paul goes back to speaking to Titus. He says, show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works. Man, why are you guys preaching so hard at me today? Like, I'm the pastor and, like, you're... Oh, man, and in your teaching, show integrity and dignity and sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us. And so, man, I don't think I'd be ready to say, like, follow the good works that I do. Like, I don't think I'd be ready to say that about my life, that I am somehow a model of good works for you guys to look at. I'm growing too. I hope I'm there, but that's obviously what I'm called to live out. And hopefully the way that the gospel is communicated, the Bible is preached, is done in a way with soundness of doctrine, of consistency of logic, that it's clear and concise, so that other people won't, right, be able to combat that, that other theologies and ideas and worldviews won't be able to kind of make an argument against it that would stand. And even the way that this is done needs to be done so in such a way that those who would oppose God's word, right, those who would be offended at it, would not have a means to kind of be like, well, see, like I told you, look at the way that, you know, they act, or look at the way that he said that, or look at the way he's running his mouth, that they would have nothing evil to say about us. Right, that what we're going to do is we're trying to limit the amount of ammunition we would give those who would attack God's word in the way that we live, right? That we're not resulting in that reviling, or we're not equipping them with a means to say evil things about us because we're failing in those ways. So let's see, verse 9. It says, bondservants are to be submissive to their own masters in everything. They are to be well-pleasing, not argumentative, not pilfering, which just means like stealing, not showing, but showing all good faith, so that in everything they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior. All right, so if you are someone who's an employee, the way that you work should be honoring to God. Right, the way that your boss sees you work, the way that you're honest in all of your dealings, the way that you are amongst your coworkers should be done in such a way that everything, in everything, they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior. Right, so that's kind of like, once again, in contrast to the idea of, instead of them reviling God's word, they find God's word beautiful because of how hard you work. Right, so in terms of like the good works that God's called us to do, that's what I was saying. This isn't like, all right, so God's called me to like go out and raise the dead and cast out demons, which maybe he has in some instances, but a majority of the good works we do will be in the way we love our families, in the way that we work hard in our community, the way that we're just simply a light to the world, the way we are consistent in speaking the truth and just demonstrating God's love. Right, those are the types of good works we're called to do, right? It's that simple. And so hopefully the way we're living produces this adorning of the doctrine of God, that it just brings an affection towards Jesus, that we're presenting him in the best possible light. And so now this passage is going to hit about what is this good news? What is this doctrine of God? Verse 11, it says, "For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age." So notice that God's grace is made available to us, because 100% of us have sinned. We've all fallen short of God's glory, but he makes forgiveness available. He makes relationship with himself available, where all of us, right, for all people, are invited back into relationship with God the Father. We can be adopted into his family, right? But I want to point out, notice that grace is not for the intent of me as a Christian to continue basking in my sin and ungodliness and just being like, look how gracious God is. That grace is intended to train us. All right, train us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions. And I want to just point this out, that the moment you become a Christian, it's not as though, like, living a godly life will just naturally come to you. It requires training. All right, training means that, like, I didn't just sit on the couch and then just get this awesome bod, right? Like, training means I worked at it, and it was out of my nature to just, like, have to go run or do push-ups or whatever, right? That training was against my instincts, and I had to go beyond those instincts to allow myself to learn how to do that thing. Okay, so God's grace is intended to train us, that when I fail and I go to God and I repent and he says, yeah, you're forgiven, don't worry, don't even bring it up again. That's not meant for me to then run away and be like, this is awesome, like I can just go and do whatever I want and he forgives me every time. Like, it's supposed to be like, wow, like I don't deserve that grace, but he gives it to me and I want to go and try to become more like Jesus, right? That's the type of training that's meant to happen. And I love this. It says that we are to live godly lives in this present age. So living a godly life is not just some like theoretical idea that we're like, yeah, it's possible, but like don't bother. Like, it's not just like some theoretical idea that we possess in our minds that living a godly life could be done. Okay? The intent is, in all practicality, we can actually live godly lives. And then, like, as if to, like, answer the question, but Paul, maybe, like, 100 years ago or 1,000 years ago, but what about now? Like, come on, like, it's really hard to live a godly life now. And, like, it even answers that question, like, no, in this present age. Which, in case you're thinking about, like, the Roman Empire and that culture, they were not, like, a society that was conducive to a sin-free lifestyle. Okay, that they had all sorts of crazy sexual sin, that just read some of the other letters to the church, you'll get an idea. Like, it was not a conducive environment to living a godly life. But Paul is saying, listen, that God's grace trains you to live a godly life in this age, in this culture, in this society, and so that we should intend on being able to, no matter how countercultural it might be, to be more like Jesus rather than like the world. Right, so I just want you to catch that. This is not some theoretical, this is a, no. Like, God intends on us doing this in our lives, in our generation today. Let's see, verse 13, and this is, in case that sounds like just some enduring thing that, like, how am I ever going to try to live a godly life in this earth? This is where our hope comes from. "Waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ." Right, we talked about this, maybe a couple months ago, I don't remember, but about the rapture, the idea that Jesus is coming back on this earth, right? That Jesus is returning, he's going to establish his kingdom, that all injustices will be made right, that he will bring about goodness, he will reestablish, right, the good that this world was intended to be, right? That's where our hope is. So in contrast to that, I want to think our purpose for going out and doing good works is not in some maybe naive is a strong word, but not in some like naive belief that by my being good to people, then they'll be good to people and the whole world will become this wonderful place. That's not what the Bible says. That's not what Jesus says. Jesus said that as the end draws nigh, like there will be wars and rumors of wars and plagues and pestilence and earthquakes. Things are going to get worse. But our hope is not in trying to make this world a better place through our own good. Our hope is to bring God's kingdom to this world, that everywhere we go, we proclaim the truth of God, that we demonstrate God's love, that we bring right prayer and hope to people's lives as they are living in, just as we are, this fallen world. And so our hope of the world becoming a better place is in Jesus, the King, returning to this world to make it the better place. Okay, so that's where our hope is. And then, just in case you didn't know how much God loves you, Jesus, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness, to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. So Jesus was willing to lay down his life that we could become his people. And notice this, right? I think I mentioned something similar last week. Jesus didn't just die so that I could be forgiven. Jesus also died that I could be, right, set free from lawlessness, that I could become pure for his glory, for himself, that I could actually go out and do good works, right? So Jesus didn't just die so that we could experience forgiveness, which he did. There's lots of reasons why Jesus died, all right? The Bible's awesome. It's full of them, all right? Just search it online. Actually, I think John Piper even has a book, 50 Reasons Jesus Came to Die. Like, you can just read a list. You'll be all set. But I want to point out that we sometimes simplify that and being like, oh, Jesus died so that I could be forgiven and I'm good. But no, he also died so that I could be set free from slavery to sin. Okay? The Bible says, Jesus said that we are slaves to that which we obey. And that when I obey sin and my own desires and worldly passions, I become a slave to that, and one of the reasons Jesus died is that I could be free from that. Okay, so it's not just simply so that I can, you know, be forgiven and live in my sin, you know, joyfully in sin. But he wants to purify us. He wants us to become more and more like him and make us a people who are zealous for good works. And so just in case you want to think about like what radical Christianity looks like, here's what a religious zealot is in the world of Christianity. It's someone who goes out doing good works, who points to the love of Jesus. Okay, so we're not talking about like Jesus wants to raise an army where we're going to go on a crusade and conquer. No, like that's not what he's calling us to do. He's calling us to be self-sacrificial in our love towards this world, that we go the extra mile, that we turn the other cheek when the wicked person would strike us, right? That we demonstrate God's love to them as a priority even over our own keeping our lives, right? That's what Jesus calls us to do. He wants us to be passionate about good works. And let's see, verse 15, let's keep rolling. All right, we're good on time. Verse 15, declare these things. So Paul's once again saying, hey, this is the sort of thing you preach, by the way. Exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no one disregard you. Verse 3, next verse, which by the way, the chapters and the verses weren't added for hundreds of years. So this was one continuous thought. He says, remind them to be submissive to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good work. Last week we talked about making no provision for the lust of the flesh. Right, that I'm not going to like store up and invest my resources and time and calendar out for future sins in my life. But here he's saying the exact opposite. He's saying I should be prepared, be ready for every good work. That we as believers should plan on setting aside resources and time for these good works that the Holy Spirit's just going to be like, hey, go do that. And it's like, all right, here we go. Like, here's one of those good works you've called me to do. This is going to be great. And I've already kind of set stuff aside. I've made myself ready for the good works that God's called me to do. Because some of them will be, you know, spontaneous, spur-of-the-moment things, and others will be things that God has been prompting your heart and giving you desires towards for a long time, right? But either way, we should be making ourselves ready for every good work. So once again, right, remind them of this, to speak evil of no one, to avoid quarreling, to be gentle, and to show perfect courtesy toward all people. Wow, like that's, Christians are supposed to be polite, I guess. And then verse 3. Here's the contrast. So if you're not a follower of Jesus, this is everyone's been in that boat. This is what Paul has to say about everyone who's ever trusted in Jesus. For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another. So in case you're trying to figure it out, we Christians had pretty much nothing to do with our salvation. Like, we did not earn God's love and favor because of our good works. All right? He just loves us even when we were his enemies. All right? And God loves everyone in our community now. So as a follower of Jesus, don't think of yourself as all high and mighty. Right? Like, this is where we came from. And we still struggle with some of this stuff. And we were foolish then. I'm going to say this. How much more foolish are we as Christians when we live as though this isn't true? Right? The Bible's saying it's foolish to live a disobedient life to God when you didn't know better, when you weren't saved. How much more foolish is it as a Christian to intentionally be living a life in disobedience to God when I should know better? Right, like, so just to point out, like, the Christians who, like, struggle with sin, which is all of us, and in those moments, we are more foolish than anybody, okay? Like, just so we're clear, we are more foolish than anybody in those moments. And the saddest part about this verse that I thought was passing our days in malice and envy. That the idea is that we could be living our lives on this earth apart from Jesus. And you might have goals, right? You might have all of these plans for your life, but your time just might be just passing by where nothing of eternal value is being accomplished, where just like you're just bouncing back and forth between one passion or pleasure to another, that you're just being led astray wherever your heart and your worldly desires are leading you, that you could live an entire lifetime and you're just simply passing your days pursuing one sin or another. It is completely distracted and missing out on what good God has called you to do. Right? Like that just because we are on this earth and God has a purpose for our lives does not by default suggest that we are fulfilling that purpose. That Jesus says in John 15 that apart from him we can do nothing. I think it's in 1 Peter it talks about for believers, he's talking about in this case, that when we do works for ourselves or we're living out of selfishness or right have wrong motives, that those works will pass through judgment and be burned up by fire. And even though we will still be saved at the end of the day, we will still enter into heaven. Anything we did, not for the glory of God, not with the right heart, not yielded to the Holy Spirit, will have zero eternal value. Right? So like when I'm encouraging us like to be zealous for good works, I want us to have the kind of maximum eternal benefit, that we're not missing out on some form of eternal joy because we're so distracted by these worldly passions that we have, that we're just distracted and slaves to the sin that we should now be free from. See verse 4. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, check this, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit. So make no mistake, there's no way we can do good works enough to save ourselves. That doesn't exist. But there is a distinction, there is a difference between pre-Jesus Brian and follower of Jesus Brian, the one who's trusted Jesus for salvation. The difference is significant. All right, it's as drastic as from going from death to life. The distance is as eternally significant as heaven and hell are far apart. Okay, like these aren't like just subtle little, I don't know, does it really matter? Like if I'm, you know, just thinking that I can be good enough to go to heaven. It matters a lot because I don't want you to have this false sense of security and false hope in thinking that your good works will be sufficient to save you. Like that's not how it works. Right? That's an insult to Jesus and what he accomplished on the cross. Because the Bible says that there is no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. Right? He came here and died because that was the only way salvation was made available to us. So don't have false hope in our works, but there is true and good hope that we can trust in Jesus our Savior. Verse 6, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. So we're justified not by our good works, but by his grace, which, by the way, is a way better way to live your life and way more joy-filled way to live your life when you realize, God, I couldn't earn this, but you loved me anyway, that you give me grace even though I don't deserve it, right? That I'm justified by his grace. So when reminders from the enemy regarding my sin come up trying to bring condemnation, I can be like, no, it wasn't about me to begin with. It's about God and his grace. That's how I'm justified. That's how I'm saved. It says, verse 8, the saying is trustworthy. I want you to insist on these things so that those who have believed in God may be careful to devote themselves to good works. These things are excellent and profitable for people. So once you have believed in God, then devote yourself to good works. Don't do it in the opposite order. All right, that's what religion would teach you. Like, I'm going to be good enough, I'll get God's attention and approval, and then I'll believe in him. Right? Then I'll trust in him. But don't do it the other way around. In terms of unfitness, right? Because that's what it said in Titus 1:15, that pre-Jesus we are unfit for any good work. Think about this, that running around doing good without having Christ is like doing steps without your Fitbit on. It counts for nothing. All right? You're going to remember that now, right? Like, if I'm trying to be good on my own without Jesus, it's not going to count for anything. It doesn't accomplish anything. There's no amount of good works by which I could be saved. Jesus said this in John 6:63, the Spirit alone gives eternal life. Human effort accomplishes nothing. Or the NLT or NIV version of that actually says that, right, it counts for nothing. So just like you're missing those steps when you don't have your Fitbit charged, think about if you're trying to get good works as a means to gain God's approval, it's not going to work. It doesn't count. It doesn't count. And it's an insult to the work that Jesus accomplished on the cross. So let's see. I've got more to go, but I want to end roughly on time. So as the worship team comes back up, I just want to, just one guy. That's fine. All of us are worshiping God today, though. But this idea is once we have believed in God, then we need to devote ourselves to good works. All right, so we want to get that order right. We want to do this in the proper order, the proper procedure, that once God has changed our lives, we are created in Christ Jesus. We are his workmanship to do good works that he's foreordained for us to walk in. All right, so we were once unfit. We are now made fit because of God bringing us to life, having trusted in him for salvation, the Holy Spirit now leading us and equipping us and developing fruit in us that makes us more and more like Jesus. That's what it's about. And now we are equipped to do good works, and not before that. All right, and that's what we're about doing here for the sake of making Jesus attractive, resulting in the world adoring his word and not reviling it, right? That's one of the reasons why we're still here. If it was just about relationship with God, the moment I trust in him, I would just go poof, and like, you'd take me to heaven, all right? God has you here for a reason. He has a plan for your life, and he wants you to accomplish it. He does not want you to be unfruitful, and he's equipped you to succeed at that plan. Let's pray real quick. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for your goodness, for your kindness, your grace, your just ceaseless love that you show us, that it appeared on this earth when it was fallen, that it shows up in our lives when we were your enemies, and God, you just make salvation available to all people. I thank you, God, that it's not a result of our own good works, but we trust in you. It's your grace that saves us. And Lord, I pray that you would just encourage us, urge us as your family, that we would be zealous for good works, that we would not be so distracted by the cares of this world, that we would not be led astray by our worldly passions, but God, that we would be accomplishing the things on this earth that you've called us to do. Lord, help us as a church family to just make you made known in this community. Help us just to speak words of sound doctrine that cannot be argued against. Help us to live lives that do not result in people reviling you. Lord, purify us. Be pleased in us, your people, God, as you make us more and more like you. And I pray, Lord, that your gospel would go forth and change this community and bring people into newness of life and relationship with you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.